This is BBC Radio 3. It's very nearly 7:30. And time now to go live to the Royal Albert Hall for this evening's prom. It's presented by Louise Fryer.
Humans, this Doctor Who prom is now under the authority of the Jadoon. All mobile phones must be deactivated. All flash photography is in breach of intergalactic law and must not be used. Stand by for further instructions.
Well, as you can tell from that announcement, the whoops and cheers and general technological rumbling, this concert will be taking the proms into a different dimension, or space-time continuum if you prefer. The London Philharmonic Choir and the BBC National Orchestra of Wales are on stage, soon to be joined by soprano Ellen Manahan-Thomas and Alan Clayton, a cast of Cybermen, Daleks, Vampire Girls, and the odd Silurian or two, plus the all-important 11th Time Lord for this celebration of 50 years of Doctor Who. And we have a message from the Doctor himself.
To all humans out there, this is the Doctor speaking. Prick up your ears, peel back your eyes, and get ready for an alien invasion of music and brilliance, an extravaganza, a bonanza. Welcome to the Doctor Who Prom 2013 on Radio 3. Woohoo!
Matt Smith, who's the 11th Doctor. Lots more from him later. Well, with me in the Radio 3 box is journalist Sean Lay, World This Weekend presenter on Radio 4 and all-round Doctor Who fan who will be our alien spotting guide to all things green and slimy or metallic and shiny. Sean, many thanks for joining me. Why, for you, has Doctor Who had such an enduring appeal?
Well, it's curious, isn't it? I grew up with the programme probably from the mid-1970s, and you tend to think of it as being a programme about monsters and laser flashes and all the visual excitement of science fiction. But in many ways, you know, a lot of it was about the sound, because where the television budget couldn't quite deliver the Star Wars-style special effects, sound, atmosphere, music, incidental music could do that. And of course, that extraordinary haunting theme music, which I very much hope we'll hear tonight in the original form, composed by Ron Grainer, arranged by Delia Derbyshire of the BBC Radiophonic Workshop. And hearing that even now makes the hairs on the back of my neck stand up.
Well, I'm sure we have that in store for us tonight, and we're also going to be finding out more during the interval about the music for Doctor Who. Murray Gold, the man behind the music for the past 8 years, he's here tonight. He was talking on In Tune on Wednesday, comparing the Doctor to an intergalactic Atticus Finch, which was an allusion I rather enjoyed. His music runs throughout the concert, interspersed of famous pieces by familiar composers, including Bach, Bizet and Debussy. And then, as I say, during the interval, there's a discussion about the music in the early years, and in particular, the role of the Radiophonic Workshop. And alongside the huge orchestral forces, we've got all sorts of tape recorders and synthesizers and various other elements arranged around the TARDIS, which has pride of place in front of Sir Henry Wood. So just on the top of the risers and surrounded by a plethora of brass as well as all sorts of other instruments. So really promises to be a very exciting time. And here comes the conductor, Ben Foster, who's made many of the orchestrations, ready to launch this intergalactic proms adventure. And following him, Ellen Manahan-Thomas. So get ready. The Doctor Who prom is about to begin. The Madman with a Box, launching this epic adventure composed by Murray Gold, performed by the BBC National Orchestra of Wales and Ellen Manahan Thomas.
I do. Next question. Who's coming to take it from me? Come on! Look at me. No plan, no backup, no weapons worth a damn. Oh, and something else I don't have. Anything to lose. So, if you're sitting up there in your silly little spaceship with all your silly little guns, and you've got any plans on taking the Pandorica tonight, just remember who's standing in your way. Remember! Every black day I ever stopped you, and then, do the smart thing.
Let somebody else try first.
Oh. I'm the Doctor.
I am the Doctor, and we're going to be taken by video link to a street near the Royal Albert Hall.
That was really disappointing.
I know, I'm sorry.
How could you not get tickets?
I didn't realise it would be so popular.
Well, you must know somebody.
Hey, why?
Doctor, it's a concert about you.
And I've got the perfect way to get us in.
What's that?
A Hyperscape body swap ticket valid for all entertainment events in the history of the universe.
Body swap?
Exactly. We just scrape off this little bit of foil here, and right now, two people sitting in the Albert Hall get deleted.
Deleted?
Yes, and we just appear in their seats.
But what about the deleted people?
Oh, they get deleted. Otherwise, we'd be sitting in their laps, and they wouldn't want that at all. I mean, imagine some young fella out there suddenly gets you in his lap. He'd be furious.
Yeah, but by deleted, you mean?
They just get sent outside. They materialise perfectly safely a few streets away.
Oh, OK.
Naked.
Naked?
Yes. We get their clothes too. It's all part of the body swap service.
Yeah, but then they're going to miss the concert. That's not very fair.
Ah, but they get compensated. A nice packet of biscuits. Jammy Dodgers, probably. Also a billion pounds, immortality, X-ray vision, a space bus, an electric camel, a house that's bigger on the inside and the outside. The legal right to marry 15 people of their own choosing and a pardon.
A pardon?
For being naked in the street.
OK, that sounds fair.
Shall we?
Go on.
So the Doctor and Clara pop up in the orchestra. The Doctor by the piano.
Hello, Albert Hall! Ah, yes! We made it! What a wonderful surprise! Thank my lucky stars! Oh, dear. Well, how wonderful to be here, and my TARDIS made it, and a piano. How exciting. If Ludwig van could see me now. Hello, choir. Hello, orchestra. Oh, and it's Ben Foster. Ben, did you get my present? Excellent. May come in handy in case of alien invasion. Let's leave it to the real maestro, shall we? Oh, where's Clara? Clara!
By the double bass.
Doctor! You promised we'd be in the audience, not in the orchestra. I don't know how to play the double bass.
Yes, yes, sorry. Well, don't panic, but at least the costume went all right. Tails and a bow tie, jackpot.
Oh! Your hair.
Oh, no, that must be the ticket. Oh, never trust a tout, especially when he's from Space Vegas. Actually, that reminds me, I've got to take you there. It's the ultimate planet for excitement. Right then, now then, orchestra, are we ready, ready, ready?
Doctor?
Yes?
Concentrate. Can we take our seats? Because everybody is waiting.
Right. Yes, of course. Ladies and gentlemen of the orchestra, my sincere apologies. Ladies and gentlemen of the audience, sorry for interrupting this prom. Benjamin, please, take this. Right. Gosh, there's a lot of you, isn't there?
Doctor!
What? Yes. Yes. You're right. Do you know, I've just heard what's next. It's Carmen. But the last time we heard it, you were a Dalek, so it's time to run.
Woo! Woo! Wrong way!
Okay. Bye! Woo!
Habanera from the second Carmen suite by Bizet, and here comes Madame Bastra and Strax, a couple of the Doctor's friends.
Hello, everyone. Welcome to this very special Doctor Who prom. My name is Vastra. The music you have just heard was a habanera from the Carmen Suite No. 2 by Georges Bizet, which featured in Asylum of the Daleks.
Madam, madam, we appear to be surrounded. There are thousands of puny humans everywhere.
Strax, Strax. These are all the Doctor's friends.
Very well, if you say so, madam. But I'll be keeping my eye on them. For now, I'll stand down the Sontaran battlefleet.
Yes, a very good idea, Strax. Today we're all here to celebrate our friend, the Doctor. I'm told that you humans have been following the Doctor's adventures for almost 5 decades. Some of us have known him much longer.
Madam, there appears to be a group of armed humans behind us. Should I hit them with pulver grenades?
Strax, these are the musicians.
Musicians? Excellent. I will teach them the rudiments of Sontaran battle music. Sontaha!
Yes.
Sontaha!
Strax, not now. All of the music that you will be hearing in this concert has been heard in Doctor Who. Most of it is by the Doctor's personal composer, Mr. Murray Gold. And... I am delighted to tell you that Murray is in the audience with us today. During the Doctor's long lifetime, he has asked some very special humans to travel with him through space and time. And this next piece remembers the most recent, four of the most recent. Here is Murray Gold's Companions Suite.
the companion suite, and the cheers you heard were for materializations of a number of Doctor Who's and their companions on huge screens around the hall and a selection of favourite moments. Here comes Strax.
Strax de Sontar. Strax de Sontar. Field report T135/2. I appear to be in a large room filled with human scum who have gathered to celebrate the Doctor. A group of them are playing music, but nothing like our glorious Santaran war music. yet others are standing, ready for battle. However, the majority are resting their weak and feeble bodies in seats. Wait. Intel just in suggests the Doctor's enemies are gathering and are preparing to attack. This next piece may provide more clues. Strax, signing off.
Don't wander off. I mean it. Otherwise, you'll wander off. And the next thing you know, somebody's going to have to start rescuing somebody. Sweet dream.
We'll be right back.
There was so much going on during that silver shard. I don't know where to start. Cybermen playing chess in the middle of the arena, others advancing, and here comes Madame Vassra again.
That was Cyber Shard. I hope no one was deleted. As the Doctor has travelled through space and time, he has met many great figures, including the composer of this next piece. Johann Sebastian Bach wrote his now famous Toccata and Fugue for organ at the beginning of the 18th century. And almost 200 years later, it was heard in a story featuring the Sixth Doctor called Attack of the Cybermen. The Doctor even plays a few notes of the Toccata on the TARDIS after disguising it as a pipe organ. Today, we're going to hear it performed in the orchestral version by Leopold Stokowski. Next, we'll turn our attention to one of the loneliest beings in the universe, the Weeping Angels. They are almost as old as the universe itself, but no one really knows where they come from. When the Doctor visits New York with Amy and Rory in Angels Take Manhattan, he discovers them everywhere, and it soon becomes clear that he is facing one of his greatest challenges.
Madam, I have just received a message from the Doctor. It is for everyone in this room. Huh? In the final chapter of Amelia Pond, he recommends you don't blink. If you do, they'll come and get you.
You have been warned.
the Toccata from Bach's Toccata and Fugue. Now, there's a weeping angel in the centre of the arena and a sax soloist stepping to the front.
There's a little girl waiting in a garden. She's going to wait a long while, so she's going to need a lot of hope. Go to her. Tell her, this is the story of Amelia Pond. And this is how it ends.
The 11th Doctor coming face to face with mortality in New York with Rory and Amy during the final chapter of Amelia Pond. Back on stage, Madame Vastra and Strax.
That was the final chapter of Amelia Pond, featuring the voice of Ellen Manahan Thomas. And so, with the last page of Melody Malone's novel, An Angel's Kiss, Amy and Rory's time with the Doctor came to an end.
Madam, permission to speak? Mm-hmm. I believe this was when the Doctor came to us for protection. It was a time when he turned his back on the universe and removed himself from the company of others. Then he met that girl.
Yes. And after losing Oswin or Clara twice, it was a phone call to the TARDIS that finally brought the two of them together in modern-day London. When the Doctor invited Clara on her first trip in the TARDIS, she asked to be shown something awesome. To bring the first half of this Doctor Who prom to a close, we are going to take you on that same journey to the rings of Akaten to witness the Festival of Offerings. Please welcome our two singers, the Queen of Years, Kerry Ingram, and Alan Clayton.
Take my memories, but I hope you've got a big appetite, because I have lived a long, long life, and I have seen a few things. I walked away from the last great time war. I marked the passing of the Time Lords. I saw the birth of the universe, and I watched as time ran out until nothing remained. Just me. And I have watched universes freeze and creations burn. And I know things, secrets that must never be told. Knowledge that will make Parasite God's place. So come on then. Take it. Take it all, baby. Have it. You have it all.
Wake up and learn.
The Rings of Akhartan, composed by Murray Gold, orchestrated by Ben Foster, who is conducting the BBC National Orchestra of Wales, led tonight by Leslie Hatfield. The London Philharmonic Choir, with Kerry Ingram, the child chorister, taking the role of the Queen of the Years with this live BBC prom, and with her, the tenor Alan Clayton. The organist was Robert Court. Well, with me is...
humans, there will now be a 20-minute interval. You must return on time or you will be deleted. You must return on time or you will be deleted.
Well, the fact that the interval announcement was made by a Cyberman there, and that the previous piece was introduced by Madame Bastra and Strax, a Silurian and her Sontaran butler, has probably given you a clue, if you needed one, that this is the Doctor Who prom, live from the Royal Albert Hall. Radio 4's Sean Lay is with me. Alan Clayton and Kerry Ingram were dressed in red satin robes as characters from the Rings of Akhartan during that last number. Was that a storyline you followed, Sean?
Yes, absolutely. And a strange idea of singing a lullaby to a destructive celestial deity called Grandfather. I don't know what that tells you about what was going on in the author's mind, but I suppose that's one of the attractions for some pretty distinguished writers. For example, Neil Gaiman has written recently for Doctor Who, and it's a real opportunity to let your imagination let rip.
And it certainly appeals to a huge age range, massive age range of audience members here.
It is remarkable, because you initially think, well, a lot of the adults are really here just because the kids want to go and they bring them along. And then you see the reaction of the adults on their faces, captured on some of the big video screens above us. But actually, if we just lean out of our box here and look among the audience, and when some of those monsters, those non-speaking actors dressed in heavy costumes that must be full of sweat by the end of the evening, it's so baking hot in here, as they careered around the auditorium, plunged into the arena, raised their weapons, or even just kind of glared at you, you could hear some of the screams and the cries of delight from adults and children alike. And it sort of, in a sense, captures the mix of fear and thrill that I think generations of children have felt, the sort of behind the sofa moment, only there's no sofa to hide behind here.
Sadly not. Well, there'll be some exclusive videos of tonight's concert available on the Proms website from tomorrow, if you'd like to check them out.